United States and North Korea the risk of war breaking out. The U.S. says it's ready to use military force against North Korea, quote, if it must, after Kim Jong-un this week test fired an ICBM missile. That missile was in the air about for 40 minutes, flew for hundreds of miles. American ambassador to the U.N., Nikki Haley, said North Korea's launch was a military escalation. And just a few minutes ago, we've heard from U.S. President Donald Trump, who was vowing to confront North Korea head-on, adding, quote, he's thinking about doing severe things. Here's the president.
Not only must we secure our nations from the threat of terrorism, but we must also confront the threat from North Korea. And that's what it is. It's a threat. And we will confront it very strongly. President Duda and I call on all nations to confront this global threat and publicly demonstrate to North Korea that there are consequences for their very, very bad behavior.
To talk about this new development from Trump's remarks just a short time ago, with me in studio, we have our Chloe Liu, defense correspondent. But first, let's go to John Hemmings in Skype, a regional expert in this matter, knows all the players involved. First question, what about diplomacy, efforts to perhaps make inroads with Kim Jong-un's government? What about bribery to get him to curb these missile tests? Is all of that off the table at this point?
Well, you have to remember, it's been on the table since 1994, when North Korea's nuclear issue rose to the top of the U.S. National security agenda. I mean, the U.S. has approached North Korea bilaterally. In 1994, the agreed framework, but of course they cheated on that by having uranium, a covert uranium processing program. And then the six-party talks, they agreed to that. So it was the multilateral approach that was all diplomatic. We were going to give them fuel, aid, and they refused to be verified. They refused to have independent inspectors go in and at least make sure they were doing what they promised to do. So since 2007, we broke down. We had Obama, of course, try one last attempt with food aid with the leap year agreement in 2012. And they agreed at least to freeze missile testing and then promptly fired off a satellite, quote unquote, 60 days later, which, you know, at that point, the White House, you know, Obama was extremely open-minded. And at that point, he threw up his hands. So Trump's hard line must be seen in historical perspective.
So, John, it certainly seems that diplomacy is not exactly working in recent years. So let me bring in Chloe to this conversation. All right, this was, for the United States, a scary new development, an ICBM missile. If this technology improves, if the missile technology gets better, and it could within the range of the United States, is the U.S. helpless here? Can they shoot it down? I mean, what does the U.S. do to defend itself?
Right. So regardless of Trump's statements, it doesn't seem that the U.S. has a very strong, viable, offensive military plans. The question is, right, what is, at least I hope they have, you know, a viable defensive plan.
Well, certainly the people in Alaska hope so.
Yeah. And so the U.S. has, they have one intercontinental ballistic missile defense system, and it's called the ground-based mid-course defense system. And this system has two ground-based interceptors, one of which is in Alaska and the other which is positioned in California. Now, this system was recently tested on May 30th, and it was actually a successful test. And the test simulated an intercontinental ballistic missile fired from North Korea. But there have been 18 such tests, and only 10 of them have been successful.
Because these missiles fly so fast.
Exactly. These missiles are coming from outer space at enormous speeds. It's a really hard target that's been described as hitting a bullet with a bullet. But what we see here is with the ground-based mid-course defense system is, you know, about a 55% success rate
for intercepting a missile. Failure rate, so
exactly.
Not great. So the U.S. shouldn't be a feeling of invincibility because these missiles, the interception rate is not exactly foolproof.
No, what happened with North Korea's July 4th missile launch is that, you know, now it's put the U.S. in a position where the U.S. defense is now having to keep up with North Korea's missile program as opposed to the other way around.
And let's bring into this conversation some remarks from United Nations, former ambassador to the United Nations, Bill Richardson. We spoke with him on the show Crossroads. He's been to North Korea. He's familiar with the weapons program. Here's his take on what's going on with the North Korea missile tests.
I've negotiated with the North Koreans for years. Ego is very important, saving face. They don't think like we do. They want to be treated like the major power in the region, not China, not Japan, not South Korea. Secondly, they want to keep their nuclear weapons. They don't want to be like Libya that gave up their nuclear weapons and then fell apart. They see that as an example. So they're sending a message. My father, my grandfather wanted to negotiate on nuclear weapons. I'm not. I'm going to keep my missiles, my nuclear weapons, but I'm going to want something in return if you want me to freeze some kind of activity. We don't know exactly if he is saying that, but I think eventually all this escalation means he's going to want something. And I think diplomacy is the way to go. A preemptive military option is not going to work. You don't want a wholesale war on the Korean Peninsula.
All right, let me talk again with John. John, you heard the remarks here. You heard from Chloe talk about, you know, a 55% success rate in shooting these things down. This isn't exactly a great ratio. What do you make of Trump's remarks just within the last hour saying that he is thinking about very severe consequences?
I think I put them in perspective. I'm hoping, as many of us are, that actually what he's going to do is really implement the very loose sanctions regime and try a diplomatic solution, but not with North Korea, with Beijing and Moscow, the enablers of North Korea.
All right, John, thank you so much for your perspective. Great to hear from you, Chloe Liu. Some scary numbers you told us, but appreciate your perspective as well, Chloe. A lot more ahead. Still to come.